capture my heart with this love, because nothing on earth is as beautiful as you.
Jesus, you endured my pain. Savior, you bore all my shame, all because of your love. Maker of the universe, broken for the sins of the earth, all because of your love. Because of your love, because of your cross, my debt is paid. Because of your blood, my sins are washed away. Now all of my life I freely give, because of your love, because of your.
Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome you here this morning, this gathering of God's people who've been called out from the world to come together, to rejoice together, to praise and worship the Lord together. As brothers and sisters in Christ, no greater thing than we can do together. Just highlight a couple announcements. Next Sunday, August 14th, can you get that? August, it's hard to believe, but August 14th, next Sunday, starting at 2 o'clock, we're going to be having our Linfield outdoor activity. It was kind of left over from our VBS that never happened on that Friday night because of rain, so we moved it to next Sunday, starting at 2 p.m. So if you would like to come for the whole thing, get there at 2 o'clock, outdoor games and activities and all, and then around 4-ish or 5-ish, something like that, we're going to be having the cookout. If you would like to volunteer to both provide some of the food, there's an online registration for that. If you would like to be involved in helping with maybe the cookout or whatever, I think it starts somewhere around 4 o'clock. Is that right, Heather? Something like that, 4 o'clock. So it's going to be a great time to fellowship with our brothers and sisters there in the Linfield community. The Myers have just recently been to Russia, so they're going to come this morning and give us a little update on their trip.
Привет. That's Russian for hello. If you'd like to know the other 10 words I know in Russian, see me after church. Well, maybe 15. Anyway, Beth, Ruth, and I would like to thank you very much for your support, for not only financially, but prayerfully. This was one of our best trips, actually, especially with the new law. Anyway, the English went very well. Sports and crafts went well, and I did not come back injured. So the new law does make it harder for you to share your faith in Russia. Basically, outside the church, if you're not a pastor or approval from the pastor, you really are could face arrest if you share your faith. So we did not run into that problem, and it was good. So please also pray for our Russian minister or missionary friends, Yana and Peter Smirnov, and the believers there. We also have a great opportunity this fall to share with them regarding a group coming. So Ruth will tell you more about that.
There's a flyer in your bulletin this morning. They're going to bring a team from October 25th to November 4th. Jan and Peter are going to be bringing 8 to 9 young people to learn English. We have an awesome opportunity here at Ebenezer to share not only English, but to share the gospel freely with them. I'm putting a program together, and I need help with different things: housing, teaching English, crafts, cooking, sports. I also need some drivers. If you're certified on the church van or want to get certified on the church van, I could use some people to do that. I'm looking for somebody that knows New York City really well that could take them around. It might have been too much for you to come to Russia with us, but this is a great opportunity for you to share with them as we can share freely here in America. Whether you can help or not, we're asking you to pray for this program and the youth that are coming. And I just want to thank you for your consideration of helping in this special ministry. Again, thank you for helping us financially and prayerfully, and do svidaniya, or goodbye in Russian. And I, too, only know about 10 to 12 words. Thank you so much.
Amen. Thank you so much. Isaiah, the prophet, had a lot of encouraging things to say about God, and some of them are things that are difficult. In Isaiah chapter 45, verse 7, at the end of verse 6, it says, "I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light, I create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity. I am the Lord who does all these things." Sometimes it's difficult to understand why God does the things he does, but God is good always. His will and his purposes are perfect. So we lean on him, we cling to him for dear life. So we've come this morning to praise and worship this God. This is the only God that there is. So let's stand and sing. Before we do so, let us greet one another warmly.
With us, and we sing, "O God, our help in ages past."
God, you are our help, you You are the Ancient of Days and worthy of our praise.
You are the Ancient of Days.
You are the Ancient of Days and worthy of our praise.
You are.
You are the Ancient of Days and worthy of our praise.
And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, Your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know You are near.
And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me.
See a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. A glorious light beyond all compare. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know You here on the earth.
And I will feel no peace. My God is with me.
And if,
my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, You never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, You never let go. For the heart that holds on, and there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise You, still I will praise You.
Sing that again.
Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on, and there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes,
I will praise.
Still I will praise You. Still I will praise You.
Singing.
Oh no, You never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, You never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, You never let go of me.
Singing.
Oh no, You never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, You never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, You never let go, Lord, You never let go of me.
Mystery of Jesus Christ. Reflect on these words.
Never let go.
Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery, He the perfect Son of Man, and in His living and in His suffering, never trace nor stain of sin. See the true and better Adam come to save the hell-bound man. Christ the great
seated. Let's go before the throne of grace this morning. Father, we come into your presence this morning because there is no God like you. Father, you create light, you create darkness, you create well-being, you create calamity. You do all these things because you are God, and your will and your way is perfect. We only observe it from a human perspective, and sometimes we find ourselves wondering, trying to understand why things happened. Yet, Father, we cling to the fact that you are God, that you are good, and your purposes and your plan is perfect. And Father, the fact that we can call you our Father is the greatest of all miracles. That you sent your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, the perfect, sinless Son of God, co-equal, co-powerful with you, Father, and the Spirit. You sent him to this earth to take on flesh like ours, that he would bear the pain and the sorrows of this life, to feel the feelings that we feel, to know the sorrows, to know the rejection, to know the exhaustion and the thirst and the hunger and all those things that we feel, and yet he did it without sin. But that he ultimately went to the cross, and there he bore our sin upon him. Our sin, our rebellion against you, he bore upon his body, and he died. And he was buried, but praise God, he rose again the third day. And he conquered death, not just for him, But all of those who you would redeem would someday be resurrected also. And the cares and the pains and the sorrows of this life will be gone. We will be like Jesus with glorified bodies. And there we will sing perfectly around the throne of grace. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive glory and honor and power and grace and majesty. Father, we thank you for the great salvation you have given us. It is times like that that causes us to really refocus our attention. So often we are distracted by this life. Things of this life hem us in and cause us to be so self-focused. But, oh, Father, help us to look to you and to cling to you and to the cross of Jesus Christ. For only in that do we have any hope. Only in the cross of Christ and the grace that you shower upon us is there any meaning to this life. We thank you for those that have come this morning. Father, we cry out to you on their behalf, for many are here this morning with heavy hearts. Many are here because they want to worship you, and yet they feel the physical limitations of their body. They feel heartbroken because of a child that is wayward. They feel heartbroken because maybe of a spouse that is wayward, or maybe they've lost a loved one. Father, I pray that you would give them the joy of their hearts. I pray that you would provide for them a peace that passes all understanding, that the joy of the Lord would fill them this morning. Lord, we praise you. We glorify your name. And Father, we want to hear from you now. We wait on the edge of our seats, as it were, to hear from you the word that you have for us this morning. Please open up our hearts. May our hearts be like fertile ground that you're going to plant seed and cause it to grow and transform our lives. Be with our brother, Pastor Tim. I pray that you would give him an anointing of your spirit, that he would proclaim your word with such great authority and power. Father, we pray this in the precious name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior and soon coming King. Amen. Well, we're excited that you're here with us this morning. You've chosen to join together with us, the body of Christ, brothers and sisters in Christ. We would pray that this time together would be a fruitful one. I'd ask you to take the time to take the black books and pass them down, and if you would sign in your attendance there, and also get from there an outline for this morning's message. If you are a visitor with us this morning, we want to especially greet you and make you feel warmly welcome, hopefully. And at the end of the service, we hope that others will make you feel welcome, but also take the time at the end of the service to greet one another and talk with one another. I know you can't talk with everybody, but you can pick somebody out and just don't just run out of here, because we are brothers and sisters in Christ. Now we're going to continue our worship time by the giving of our tithes and offerings. A bit back to the Lord of what he's given to us. He's given us so much, so why should we withhold anything that he has given us? So let's take time to worship in our giving.
Trust in the Lord. Praise the Lord. Good to see you this morning in the house of the Lord. Open your Bibles to the book of 1 Peter. As we're this summer closing out the book of 1 Peter, we've been studying 1 Peter together. We're learning how to stand firm in our faith. There is nothing more important in our life. It doesn't matter if you have a whole lot of money, a whole lot of fame, but what matters is that you have faith in the Lord Jesus. That's the only thing you can take with us. And Peter is encouraging us to stand firm through life's difficult trials, through suffering, through heartache, all of these kinds of things. And we're closing the last chapter of 1 Peter. We're closing it out today, not today, but over the next few weeks. But we're in a little series I've entitled Becoming a Congregation Like Jesus. And at the end of 1 Peter, Peter is exhorting us with a series of exhortations. And if you will, he's giving us a list of what it looks like to be like Christ. He's giving us, if you could use Paul's words, the fruit of the Holy Spirit. These are Peter's fruit of the Holy Spirit, and he's telling us that we must be submissive. Remember, we looked at that a couple of weeks ago, that one of the marks of a mature Christian is that we're submissive to authority. Secondly, we looked at the idea of being humble. And Peter says we're to be humble. We saw that in chapter 5, verse 7. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and at the proper time, He will exalt you. Last time we were together, we saw a third characteristic, the characteristic of trust. Peter says, casting all your cares upon Him, for He cares for you. And then today, we're going to see one word. We're going to see the word sober-minded. And this morning, I want to talk to you about being self-controlled. So we're going to study God's Word together, 1 Peter chapter 5. We're just going to study, surprisingly, one word today. One word for the next 30, 40 minutes. We're going to see what the Bible says about self-control. If you have a Bible, open your Bible up. If you don't have a Bible, there's a pew Bible, page 1016. Turn there. And as we like to do every week, would you stand with me in honor of God's Word? We're going to look at chapter 5. We're going to begin in verse 5. And read down just to the first word in verse 8. All right, so again, this is a series of characteristics that Peter is wanting us to have as we wait for the Lord Jesus to return. So let's look, chapter 5, verse 5. Clothe yourselves, all of you, here it is, with humility toward one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time He may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on Him, because He cares for you. Be sober-minded. This is the word of the Lord. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, we love You. We thank You for Your word. Lord, oftentimes we just skip over the word so quickly. We long to be transformed by it. We pray that now Your word, the power of the Holy Spirit, would come alongside of us, change us, transform us into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why You saved us, to transform us into the image of the Son, the Lord Jesus. So help us to become a congregation that looks like Jesus. Help us to become mature in our walk with the Lord, that we might be submissive and humble. Lord, that we might be trusting. And Lord, that we're going to learn today, Lord, may we be a people who have self-control. Help us, O God, now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Be seated. Keep your Bibles open this morning. We want to learn this morning from God's Word. Peter tells us that we're to be a sober-minded people. This is a word that I'm going to use here, maybe a little more simply understood. Peter is telling us to be self-controlled. And again, we could say this is definitely one of the fruits of the Holy Spirit, right? The fruit of the Holy Spirit in Galatians chapter 5, love, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control. This is the word that Peter uses right here in verse 8, sober-minded. In fact, it's in a couple other verses, other passages throughout Scripture, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and I don't know if I give you some of these verses, but maybe this might help us understand the word a little bit. Look at what the Apostle Paul said, "For you are all sons of light and sons of day. You are not of night nor of darkness, so then let us not sleep as others do, but let us be alert and be sober." To be sober, to be sober-minded. For those who are asleep, do their sleeping at night. Those who get drunk at night. But since we are of the day, let us be sober. There it is again, same word. Let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love as a helmet, the hope of salvation. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 5 uses the same word. But you are to be sober in all things. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. 1 Peter chapter 1, we saw this when we were in 1 Peter. Therefore, Peter says, gird up your minds for action. Keep sober in spirit. Fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. There are other verses, but here's the idea. I think the King James, the New American Standard, translates this word sober. ESV does as well. I think the NIV translates the word self-controlled. That we be a people who have self-control in our lives. Now let me ask you, is there anything that you have no control over at this moment in your life? The Scripture teaches us very clearly that we are to be a people who bring all of our lives under the control of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Word of God. So I want to give you 4 points this morning, very practical message. We're learning how to become like Christ. And maybe the Lord, Holy Spirit, I believe, will prompt your heart this morning to think about some things that you need to work on. The Holy Spirit might need to give you power and grace in your time of need to become what God wants you to become. All right? So this is a very practical message. I'm going to look at the first 2 points very quickly. Then we're going to look at the third point and the fourth point really are the practical aspects. Theology in the first 2 points, practical stuff in the second, third, and fourth. All right, so here's point number one. We think about self-control. What's the basis of our self-control? How is it that we are able to have self-control? Well, we think about this from a theological standpoint. Only those who are born again can truly exercise what we would call self-control. Self-control over our minds, over our bodies, over our desires, over our flesh, over those things. The world, the Scripture teaches that we have three enemies, right? Satan, the world, and our flesh. And we know the ungodly, those who are unconverted, those who are not born again, have no control over their lives, really. In fact, the Scripture teaches that they are slaves to sin. They're slaves. They only are able to do what sin enables them to do. 1 John chapter 3, verse 9 is a very clear verse. The Apostle John says this about this issue. Whoever has been born of God does not sin. Why? Because his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he has been born of God. Something radically happens to us when we become a Christian. Maybe you've forgotten about this. You've forgotten about the power that comes inside of you when you become a Christian. It's not just you on your own outliving your life on your own. The scripture teaches that there's a seed in us. And what is that seed? It's the seed of the Holy Spirit who gives us power. And the fruit of the Holy Spirit is the ability to control ourselves, to control our minds and control our bodies and control our emotions and control all of ourselves, our words, these kinds of things. We have the ability to control ourselves because the seed lives in us. And notice what the Apostle John says, whoever has been born of God does not sin. Well, how does he not sin? Well, it doesn't mean that he never sins, but the practice of sin in his life has been broken. It's been broken. Why? Because we have a new power in our life. We have the power of the Holy Spirit. Romans chapter 6, verse 5, and you don't have to turn there, but the Apostle Paul said there, we've been united with him in death. We shall also be united with him in his resurrection like his. And we know that the old self has been crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. All right, so something drastically happens to us when we're Christians. And the basis of self-control is this power that comes within us. It's the power of the Holy Spirit. You must be born again, Jesus said. And if you're not born again, you are not one of His. If you don't have the Holy Spirit in your life, you're not one of His. So here's the first question I want to ask you. Do you have the Holy Spirit in you? Are you a Christian? If you're a Christian, then you're able to have victory. You're able to be sober-minded. You're able to have self-control in your life. It's not you doing it. It's the power of the Holy Spirit within you. We're able to love Christ. We're able to follow the Lord. We're able to keep the commandments of God, not because of who we are, but because of the power that is within us. The fruit of the Spirit is self-control. We're able to control ourselves, right? So that's the basis. That's the theology behind what Peter is saying. There's a second thing here. Number two, I want to just briefly talk about this motivation. What is the motivation for why we would be self-controlled? And these first two points kind of underline the foundation of where we are and who we are as Christians. We're born again. Because we're born again, here's why we want to be self-controlled. We fear the Lord and we love Christ. Maybe these are new terms to you, but the scripture is abundantly clear with all of these phrases that we fear the Lord. The beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord, right? So we fear God. We fear displeasing Him. We fear dishonoring Him. We tremble at Him. It's not like we tremble like we're scared of the dark, but we have a holy reverence, a holy awe toward God. And because of that, we're going to get to the practical application here in just a minute. Because of that, we have a desire to bring ourselves under the control of the Word of God. So here are the biblical motivations for self-control: fear of the Lord and the love of Christ. The love of Christ. Jeremiah 32, verse 40, God promises that He will put fear in our hearts so that the children of Israel will not depart from me. Depart from me. So here's the motivations for self-control. John chapter 14, verse 15. Jesus Himself said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. So at the very foundational level of who we are as Christians, we're born again. And because we're born again, there ought to be a fear of God, and there ought to be a love for Christ. And let me ask you, do you have that in your life? Do you have that? Is that motivating you to make change in your life? Is that motivating you to do what you're supposed to do, to obey the commandments of God, right? To obey Him, to love Him, all right? So at the very fundamental level, here's why we do what we do. Now, the unbeliever, you think for just a moment, the unbeliever, they don't fear God, nor do they love God. But we fear God, and we love Him. All right, so now let's dive into the practical part of this, because Peter tells us we're to be sober-minded. We're to be sober-minded. All right. So what does this look like? And what is number three? What is the extent of this? What is the extent of this? Well, when Peter says we're to be sober-minded, what is he saying? We're to be self-controlled. Well, I want to challenge us to think about this morning, that we're to bring our whole lives under the obedience of Christ, all of our lives. In fact, you can see on your outline there, I try to summarize the whole of our life. You can see it there, our body, our thoughts, our emotions, and our words. You could kind of summarize your whole life into those four different categories. Now, Peter doesn't give us all the details of this, but he tells us we're to be controlled, we're to be sober, we're to think rightly, we're to bring our minds under the control of Christ so that all of our lives, whether we eat or drink, whatever we do for the glory of God, right? All right? So I want to, for just a moment, with some practical application, I want us to talk about ways that we can bring ourselves under self-control for the glory of God. And some of these are very convicting. I thought of these as I put them together. This sermon is for me. This sermon is not just for you. It's like last week's sermon. We talked about worry. I think all of us related to worry. Well, today I think all of us can relate to all of these things. There's some areas in our life, in the Christian life, that we need to bring under the control of the gospel and the control of the Lord and the Word of God, all right? So let's look at this. Self-control is the believer's wall of defense, if you will, against sinful desires that wage war against our soul. Charles Bridges said this about self-control: a person without self-control is an easy prey to the invader. He yields himself to the first assault of his ungoverned passions, offering no resistance, having no discipline over himself. Temptation becomes the occasion of sin and hurries him on to fearful lengths that he didn't even realize would happen to him, like anger that would lead to murder, or unwatchfulness over lust that would plunge someone into adultery. So self-control is this wall of defense that God gives us as believers. Now, here and again, I'm not talking to unbelievers. I'm talking to you as a believer. You've been born again. God is giving you the ability to be sober-minded, to have self-control as a wall of defense against the sinful desires that wage war against your soul. All right? So let's talk about these for just a moment. Let's talk about these. And by the way, before we dive in here, oftentimes we put these in the negative, but we're going to talk about some of the positive things. Self-control not only helps us to put aside the negative things, but also gives us the power and the ability to do the positive things, like read my Bible. I should want to read my Bible, right? That's not a negative thing, but I have enough self-control to do that, all right? So let's look at the four areas. The first one is our bodies, our bodies. Well, the Apostle Paul said this first before we dive into our bodies. Look at what he said: all things are lawful for me, but not all things are beneficial. They're not beneficial, helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. All right, so that's the premise. We're not going to be dominated by anything. All right, so now let's dive in here. Here's the bodies. Number one, our bodies. Our bodies. There are three major areas of temptation in our bodies, and you can write them down: gluttony, laziness, and sexual immorality. Gluttony, laziness, and sexual immorality. Self-control of our body should be aimed at least at these three primary physical temptations. First, gluttony. Gluttony, we think about our bodies, that we should have control over what we eat, that we're not dominated by food, but that we have self-control over what we put into our mouths. The Apostle Paul said the Cretans were always liars and always gluttons, right? For Titus chapter 1, verse 12. Speaking about the Cretans, they're gluttons. Maybe you don't know what gluttony is. Let me just define it for you. You're just dominated by food, right? You're dominated by food. Food dominates you. It dominates your desires. It dominates your thoughts. And you eat extensively. You eat too much. You take the good things that God gives us, and God did make good food, right? In the garden, these things were good to eat. But when we carry it too far, it becomes sinful. So gluttony is a problem, isn't it? I thought of this a couple of nights ago. We had a wedding this weekend. Andrew Batilla got married. Of course, he had his rehearsal dinner at Shady Maple. Yeah, my first time to Shady Maple. And here I am now preaching on gluttony. Of course, I had two pieces of pie. One piece of cake. They were little, okay? But I got to thinking about this as I went into Shady Maple. Maybe you don't know what Shady Maple is. It's the largest smorgasbord buffet food place I've ever seen in my life. There's every kind of food that you can imagine, every kind of drink, every kind of dessert. It's not a place for someone who struggles with eating. You should not go to Shady Maple, all right? You should not go there if you struggle with food, addictions, and eating, those kinds of things. We should be careful not to allow our appetites to rage out of control. That leads into sin. Now, I could also add other things in there as well. I'm gonna throw in the word smoking. Some of you smoke. You should get a hold of that. The Apostle Paul said, I will not be dominated by anything. One, it's bad for you, bad testimony, and then it's you shouldn't be dominated by it. You should be able to have enough self-control. The Holy Spirit in you can help you overcome that. And if you're struggling with that, then we need to come alongside of you and help you as well. We could throw in alcohol as well. I hope that you as a Christian don't have a problem with alcohol and drinking and drunkenness. We could throw that in there as well, drinking. The second word there is the word laziness. And I want to highlight that for just a moment because the scripture says very clearly that we are to work. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 says, if you don't work, you're not to eat, right? That's the principle that Christians are to be diligent workers. We're not to be lazy. And I think not many of us in this room probably struggle with laziness. Maybe you struggle a little bit with laziness. But I mean, we try to keep up our houses, right? We mow our yards, we keep the house clean, those kinds of things. We work hard at our jobs and those kinds of things. But let me just challenge you for just a moment from the spiritual standpoint. Mark chapter 1, maybe this will bring about a little conviction. It sure did me. Mark chapter 1, verse 35 says, the Lord Jesus, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up and left the house and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Oftentimes we think of laziness in terms of work, but let me ask you, are you lazy in your spiritual life? Are you lazy in your spiritual life? Some of you don't have a time with the Lord on a regular basis. Here, while it was still dark, Jesus got up and left the house. And if you follow the context of Mark chapter 1, the previous day, he healed the sick. Hundreds of people came to him. They were bringing him to Jesus. Demon-possessed were healed. The whole town, in fact, came out to Jesus. And he could have said, you know, I really had a hard day yesterday, and I really don't feel like getting up and having communion with my Heavenly Father this morning. But no, he did. And some of us, I would probably be willing to bet this morning that many of us in this room are lazy when it comes to our own spiritual walk. We don't have a consistent, regular time with God in our quiet times. Now, the Holy Spirit wants us to be sober-minded. He wants us to be self-controlled. He wants us to be disciplined, to have a time with the Lord. I suspect a number of us, even in this room this morning, don't have a productive time of fellowship with God every day. It's a small priority in your life, and yet it was a major priority in Jesus' life. And Jesus was disciplined. He wasn't lazy in his spiritual life. When was the last time you had a quiet time? When was the last time you faithfully read God's Word? Every day. I've been meeting with some guys, trying to challenge them on a daily basis. We're going to read God's Word 20, 30 minutes every day. We're going to be disciplined every day to read God's Word. Laziness. And then the last one, of course, with our bodies, sexual immorality. It's a big one. I hate to even say that we ought to talk about it among Christians, and yet among Christians, I hear of it all the time. Yet the scripture says we are not to practice sexual immorality. There is a need for self-control over our bodies. And the only place sex can be enjoyed is in the context of the marriage bed. If you're married, that's fine. If you're not married, God's standard is abstinence. Abstinence. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, look at this verse. He uses the word control here. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you abstain from sexual immorality, that each one of you knows how to what? Control his own body in holiness and in honor, not in the passionate lust like the Gentiles who don't know God. You see, this is an illustration of the Gentiles. They're out living their life like passionate, you know, animals, and they have no control. They don't know God. If you're participating in sexual immorality, you need to get that under control. This is not godly. This is not the practice of godliness. All right, so we're going to bring our bodies under control. Our bodies. Every part of our body. The way we eat, the way we work, the way we do spiritual things, our whole life, right? So that's the first area, our bodies. How are you doing with your body? You doing good? You being disciplined? Timothy says bodily discipline is good, partly good. Discipline yourself. All right, here's the second area, thoughts. And we could preach a whole sermon on each one of these. We're just highlighting them for us to think about this morning. Bring our thoughts under the control of Christ, right? 2 Corinthians 10, verse 5 says that we're to bring all of our thoughts captive to the obedience of Christ. You say, well, what kind of thoughts? Lustful thoughts are not right. Greedy thoughts, hateful, mean thoughts, jealous thoughts, selfish thoughts. We're to bring our thoughts under control. And you say, well, I mean, I'm failing here. Well, yeah, we're all failing here. And we're here in just a minute. We're going to talk about growing. We're all growing in self-control. It doesn't happen overnight. But as you day by day by day bring your thoughts under control, Job 31:1, Job said, I've made a covenant with my eyes not to look lustfully after a woman, right? I'm controlling my eyes. I'm controlling my thoughts. The best guideline, of course, for this is Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, and I give that verse to you. The Apostle Paul said, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, commendable, if there's anything of excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Well, you say, well, you know, Pastor, you know, it's not really hurting anybody for what I'm thinking about, you know? And I mean, nobody knows. It'd be scary if everybody could know what we're thinking, right? I think they made a movie about that, didn't they? Somebody could really get into your mind and know what you're thinking. How horrible would that be? We would tremble if people knew what we thought, right? Our sinful thoughts, we've got to control them and focus our minds on these things that are good and pleasing. You say, well, you know, these things don't really matter, do they? Well, they do matter. Jerry Bridges said this. Let's listen closely to what Jerry Bridges said. He said, our minds are mental greenhouses. You know what a greenhouse is? A greenhouse grows stuff, right? Our minds are mental greenhouses where unlawful thoughts, once planted, are nurtured and watered before being transplanted into the real world of unlawful actions. People seldom fall suddenly into gluttony. People seldom fall suddenly into immorality. These actions are savored in the mind long before they're enjoyed in reality. The thought life then is our first line of defense in the battle of self-control. He said that in this great book, a classic book called The Practice of Godliness, Jerry Bridges. You ought to read it. It's a classic. If you need a book to read, this is one to read. The Practice of Godliness. The other one is The Pursuit of Holiness. Jerry Bridges did an incredible job on both of these books, The Practice of Godliness and The Pursuit of Holiness. You say, well, I didn't think it really matters. Well, it does matter. You know why it matters? Because God knows. God knows our hearts. God knows our thoughts. That's why our prayers should be Psalm 19, verse 14. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. By the way, what gets in our minds? How do we guard our minds? The Proverbs chapter 4 says we're to guard our hearts, which is really a symbol for our minds, our whole being. We're to guard our minds. Typically, our minds are fluctuated through our eyes and through our ears. We listen to certain musics. We listen, we hear, we read, we see, and this information comes in through our eye gate, comes in through our ear gate. Pornography on the computer or wherever or whatever, these things fill our minds, and then before you know it, these thoughts just overwhelm us. Again, no man said before he got married that he was going to commit adultery, and yet these thoughts that just dominate them. So we must bring our thoughts under control. Every thought captive. Third, our emotions. Maybe you've not thought of this, our emotions. Uncontrolled anger, rage, resentment, self-pity, bitterness, and I don't have time to talk about all of those. But think about your emotions. Are there some emotions in your life that are uncontrolled? Do you have a problem with uncontrolled anger? We talked a little bit about that last week. Emotions that are uncurbed. Uncurbed. I love Proverbs 16, don't you? This verse. You remember this verse? Whoever is slow to anger is better than the mighty. And he who rules his spirit, what is that? That's self-control, is better than he who takes a city. If you're able to control your emotions, control your anger, and by the way, let me just say this again, if you're a Christian, you should be able to do this. If you're a Christian, the basis of self-control is the power of the Holy Spirit in you. You should be able to control your anger. You should be able to control your bitterness. You should be able to control your resentment. You should be able to control this, you know, self-pity. I know people that just wallow in their self-pity. Oh, woe is me, woe is me. Look, get a hold of your mind. Preach to yourself, get a hold of your mind. And control your thoughts and your emotions. Resentment, bitterness. I know people that are bitter, 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 bitter people. Unforgiving people. It becomes a cancer inside of us. And then the last, number four, is obviously our words, right? Our words control what comes out of our mouth. We're able to control those things. So here's our whole life. James chapter 3 says, if any man is able to control his tongue, he's a perfect man, a mature man. Here's the mark of someone who is a mature Christian. He's able to control his body and his thoughts and his emotions and his words. His words, he's able to control those things in his life. Hateful words, inappropriate words, curse words. That's inappropriate for the Christian. And may I say this very, very bluntly here. If you're a Christian, you're saying, oh God, oh my God, OMG, and you're putting it on Facebook and you're doing, look, control that. That's dishonoring to God. Oh God should not come out of your mouth unless you're praying to Him or loving Him. These slang words are inappropriate for us. Sometimes they slip, don't they? So we need to continue to grow. We're all growing in self-control. We're all growing. We're all becoming what God wants us to become. We're not there yet. We struggle with all these. Every one of us in this room, we struggle somewhere in one of these areas, in our body, in our emotions, right? In our mind, in our words. All of us struggle in all of these things. But we're hopefully on a journey to become what God wants us to become. We're becoming a congregation like Jesus. So we're becoming sober-minded. We're bringing all these things captive to the obedience of Christ. So here's the last point, and it's really important. Number four, how do we do this? The method. How do we grow in our self-control? Well, number four is this. We must continue to grow in self-control by training ourselves. Training ourselves to become what God wants us to become. All right, so let me give you a couple of things here, three things to think about, just by way of application as we think about how to grow. And all of us are growing, aren't we? We're growing. Some of us are further down the road than others. But all of us need to be growing in this ability to control ourselves. All right, so here's the first thing that must take place. Number one, know yourself, know your struggles. All right, think about this for just a moment. You know yourself better than anybody. God knows you better than you know yourself. But you need to know yourself. Know where your struggles are. Know where your patterns of failure are. If you're struggling with lust, okay, let's get a hold of that, right? If you're struggling with gluttony, let's get a hold of that. You know the areas where you've been unfaithful. You know the areas where you have certain desires and certain enticements come and drag you away, as James chapter 1 verse 14 says, that we're drawn away by our own desires and our own enticements, right? When desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is full grown, it gives birth to death, brings forth death. So we know this in our own lives. There's the enemy of the flesh within us, and we know these things. We know the lusts that come against our spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 17 says that there's going to be this war that's going to go on in all of us. The flesh is going to give war against the spirit, right? For the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are in contrary to one another, so that you don't do the things that you wish to do. Galatians chapter 5, verse 17. Now, I think the big issue for us is not so much the outer, but the inner. I think some of us, we are able to control ourselves on the outside, but the battle is really on the inside, isn't it? In our heart of hearts and in our minds. So we need to know ourselves, all right? So know yourself, know where you struggle, be aware of those things and be willing to deal with them. All right, here's number two, and this is important. Take steps to avoid sin. Take steps to avoid sin and grow in self-control, right? And grow in holiness. All right, so I want to give you a couple of steps. What would the steps be? Well, here's the first one, and I think you could probably figure these out. Number one, to the best of our ability, control your environment and control your companions. Try to control your environment. If you struggle with alcohol, don't go to the bar, right? If you struggle with something, don't go near it. Don't go near it. Run from it. Run from it. As best you can, be able to control your environment around you so that your sinful desires and thoughts wouldn't be stimulated, your words or acts or whatever. You're able to do that. If you're struggling with pornography, which many are, do something to cut that off. Put guardrails up. Put things up that will prevent you to get those. I mean, if you're serious about it. You're really serious about becoming the man of God or the woman of God that you want to be, that God wants you, then you need to be serious about your sin and take steps, take real steps to hold yourself accountable. Companions is also very important, isn't it? Bad friends corrupt. They corrupt. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33. Bad company corrupts good morals. If you're around people that are doing sinful things, maybe it's time to find new friends, new companions. And that doesn't just go for teenagers. That's for all of us, isn't it? All of us. We want to be around people who help us to walk with God. That's why Scripture says, don't be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. It doesn't mean that we're not friends, not sharing the gospel, but our best friends can't be unbelievers. We don't have fellowship with them. Now, granted, I'm not saying don't go out and witness to them. We should definitely witness to them, but the intimate friendships, yeah, we need to be careful there if they're going to lead us down the wrong path. All right, so that's the first step. Second step, and this is so important, be faithful to use the spiritual means of God's grace. And I'm going to give them all to you. You know them. Here's the Word of God, right? Corporate worship, Christian fellowship, and obviously prayer. All of these things are the graces of God that God's given us so that we can overcome these things. They're so important in our life. The Word of God, we ought to be reading it every day. We ought to be coming together in corporate worship. We ought to have Christian fellowship where we're rubbing up next to our brothers and sisters and asking ourselves hard questions and keeping ourselves accountable to one another. And then obviously prayer. We're going before the Lord and we're praying and asking God to help us. Help us, oh God. Lead us not into temptation. We're praying. And again, I'm just highlighting these things for you. We could talk long about all of these things, but here's what we've got to do. We've got to be self-controlled people. And if you neglect these graces, if you're not reading the Word of God, if you're neglecting corporate worship, if you're neglecting fellowship with brothers and sisters, that's why our kinship groups are so important. If you're neglecting prayer in your life, how in the world are you going to have victory over whatever is dominating your life? The Apostle Paul said, I will not be dominated by anything. Self-control. And then here's the last thing. Number three, repress and replace. Put on and put off. Put off the old, put on the new. If you struggle with lying, put off lying and put on the truth, right? Put on the truth. If you struggle with stealing, put away stealing and work hard. There's got to be a replacement for that thing. And as you do these things, God will develop godliness and holiness in your life. And you'll become like Christ. You'll begin looking like Christ as you are a person who has self-control over all areas of life, body, thoughts, emotions, words. You're taking the necessary steps in order that you might become the man or woman or boy or girl of God that God wants you to become. All right? So one little word that Peter tells us, self-controlled, sober-minded. We're able to bring our mind under control so that all of our life will bring honor and glory to God. You know, as we grow in self-control, we certainly will grow in godliness, and we certainly will become like Christ. So how are you doing this morning? How are you doing? How are you doing in your self-control? Is there an area of your life the Holy Spirit brought to your attention? You know, I'm not doing well there. I'm not doing well in my spiritual quiet times. I haven't been faithful like I should be. I've been lazy in my spiritual walk. What area is God calling you to work on so that you can become a congregation that looks like Jesus? There's some area that we need to work on. All of us, really all of us, fail. And we won't be made perfect until Jesus comes again. And that's, to be honest with you, that's why I love the Lord's table, don't you? We're going to celebrate the Lord's table this morning. We come to the Lord's table at a time like this, and we're reminded that we need God's grace, don't we? We need His grace. Because if every one of us in this room, there's some area that dominates us at times, right? And we need forgiveness. We need the grace of God that forgives us. And that's what the Lord's table reminds us of, that yes, we have failed. We have failed here and here and here. But we're not trying to earn our salvation. We've been saved by the body and the blood of Christ. His body broken, His blood spilled out on our behalf. And so we come to the Lord's table with joy, knowing that we have been forgiven of all of our sins. Bow your heads with me as we come to a close. Do you know Christ this morning? Maybe there's someone in the room that doesn't know Christ. We beg you to come to Jesus Christ. He and He alone can forgive you of your sins. You need your sins forgiven. You need your life forgiven. It's not that you're trying to earn your way to heaven. You can't pull yourself up by your bootstraps. There's no way you can make it to heaven on your good works. You need forgiveness. If you're not a Christian, we beg you to come to Christ. And if you are a Christian this morning, we welcome you to participate in the Lord's table. Heads bowed, eyes closed, as the men who are going to help me with the Lord's table will come forward this morning. Won't you take just a moment to prepare your hearts and ask the Lord to forgive you for some things in your life that you need to ask for forgiveness for? He's going to bring them to your mind. Maybe you have resentment or bitterness towards someone else. Are you willing to go get that right with someone? Are you willing to go and ask for forgiveness? Reconcile with your brother or sister? Maybe you've been lazy in your spiritual walk. Maybe you've been a glutton. Who knows what it is that the Lord brought to your attention today? Won't you take just a moment and say, I'm so thankful, Jesus, that Christ has forgiven me. The cross washes away all my sin. I love the cross of Christ. I hope you know the cross this morning. The grace and the mercy that comes at the cross, and He promises to clean us. If you're a believer this morning, won't you thank God for His grace, for His mercy, for His cleansing power? Give grace. Give thanks to God. Give praise to God. Prepare your hearts. If you're a believer, we invite you to participate in the Lord's table. And let's rejoice. Father in heaven, we come to a passage like this where we've been told that we've got to be sober-minded. And every one of us in this room this week, if not already today, have not obeyed that command. We fall and fail in so many ways. We fail in our bodies, in our minds, in our emotions. We fail in our words to be able to control ourselves. And yet we come to the Lord's table and we're so thankful for grace. We're so thankful for mercy. We're so thankful that we don't earn our way to heaven by our good works, but we've been washed clean by the body and the blood of Christ spilled out on our behalf. That those who put their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ will be cleansed. And so, Father, we celebrate this morning. We thank You that while we were yet enemies, Christ died for us in our place as a substitute for us. He bore our sins, all of them, on the tree that we might have everlasting life. Thank You. We rejoice in that. We celebrate now all that You've done for us. Bless now as we celebrate. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Come.
Give His only Son to me. which mark the chosen one, bring many sons to glory.
Why should we gain from his reward? I don't know. But we know that all of our sins have been paid by the blood of Christ. The night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. He broke it. He said, "This bread is my body, which is broken for you. As often as you eat it, do so in remembrance of me." In the same way he took the cup, he said, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood." The new covenant. Sins will not be forgiven by the blood of goats, but by the blood of the Savior, the Messiah. As often as you drink it, do so in remembrance of me. Amen. And all God's people said, amen. Praise the Lord. Every first Sunday of the month, we take up a benevolent offering to help those in our church who are struggling, help those outside of our community that are struggling. You don't have to give, but if you're prepared to give a little extra above your normal giving to help those in need, this is your opportunity to do so.
Shelter of the Most High God. shield and my great reward. I will not be afraid. I will trust in the Lord. You have set me securely on high. You deliver. Shelter of the Most High God, I will rest in the beauty of your presence. Your faithfulness is a shield and my great reward. I will not be afraid. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord.
With us as we sing the bridge, no weapon formed against me.
No weapon formed against me will prosper. No weapon formed against me will prosper. No weapon formed against me will prosper, says the me will prosper. No weapon formed against me will prosper. No weapon formed against me will prosper, says the Lord. I will dwell in the shelter of the Most High. Shield and my great reward. I will not be afraid. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in.
Aren't you excited that the Olympics are on? I'm excited because it's a fun time to root for our country. But did you know that all are in a race, but not all runs? Not everyone receives the prize. So run that you may obtain. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. So we're in a race. The Olympics are there for 1 week, but we're in a race for life. So may we run the race set before us, knowing that the prize is coming, all right? So live your lives with self-control this week. If you're here, we're having a new member class starts tonight. If you didn't sign up, it's not too late to do that. Welcome you to come do that. Come learn a little bit more about our church. Hope you have a great week. Lord bless you. You're dismissed.